morning, my brother.
Good morning.
Is the light on my mic on? All right, thank you. Thank you. Good morning, brothers and sisters, God bless you. Welcome to our worship. We'd like to invite you to be ready for a different, vibrant serving this morning. We're going to do a few things a little bit different, so we hope that you are open and willing to join us. The processional we would do, I'd like to, those of you that have palms, as the choir processes upward, you're welcome to join them. We're going to make one circle around the church and then go around and come back to our seats. Okay? So join us in that. And at the end of worship, the last song, the closing hymn, is going to be done together with the choir. So be ready to follow along with us on that as well. All right? Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Good morning, welcome.
Good morning.
And welcome to First Fulton United Methodist Church. We're so glad to have you here and online. I'm Dan Warner. I'll be your worship leader today. This is our pastor, Ruth Rosa Warner. Our AV folks are Dan Crast and John Smith. Our ushers are Don Dyack, Ricky Chase, and Sandra Green. Our musician is Lois Marabito. And we're so glad to have you. If there's any brief announcements that anybody has?
I have a few. While those that are sharing come, I'd like to let everybody be reminded that this coming Sunday, next is Easter, but starting in April, every Sunday at 9 a.m., we're going to start the Foundations Academy. This paper inside of your bulletin is a reminder. The Foundations Academy would be a time for us to draw closer together to Jesus. I never turned that off, so it should be fine. Closer to Jesus together, unless my battery died. Must be.
I can hear.
My battery died because I turned it on. 1, 2, 3. Glory to God.
No. Nope.
1, 2, 3, 10.
This one works.
Go ahead, Al.
This one works. good morning. I just wanted to let you know that it's getting close to spring now, and it's time for the community garden. Any of you are interested in a plot, please let me know. Thank you.
Glory to God.
Good morning. My name is Michelle Gilbert. I plan and execute the rummage sale, which is now less than 2 weeks away. It is April 5th and 6th from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. I have household items, holiday decorations, gently used furniture, games, toys, purses, crafting supplies, books. I have a lot of stuff. And I've seen lots of posters around. I'm starting to put up the signs in the there's the one out here by the church. I just put one near Brett's. I have some more to put in the city. Please share it on Facebook, share it with your friends. I have lots of these posters. If you want to hand them out to anybody, take a bunch of them. We need to get people here to buy the stuff. Everything is reasonably priced. Hopefully it's going to be a good fundraiser for our church. Thank you.
All right, so starting next, the first Sunday in April, we're going to do the Foundations Academy. Those of you that are interested, I'm going to have the sign-up sheet next Sunday so we can all sign up. And there's some information in this. If you have any questions, reach out and let me know. In addition to that, those of you that ordered flowers, we will be setting them up on Sunday. And after worship, remember that you would be taking them home after Easter Sunday. And wanted to let those of you that were interested in going to the closer walk, that the women's walk now in April still have some availability space-wise. So they will be sending you a notification, and you need to say whether yes or no you want to participate. If there's anybody here that is interested in going and hasn't signed up yet, please provide me your information from the application or sit with me so we can do the application together. I also wanted to say thank you very much out loud to all of you that have been helping decorating in the narthex, decorating in the sanctuary. Glory to God. Give him a hand. Doesn't this look so beautiful? Thank you for your help with that, everybody. And the last two announcements, the next prayer buddies delivery will be April the 20th. April the 20th is a Saturday. And the invitation is for us to gather here at 12:30, pray over the bears together, go over to the place, and get ready to deliver them. And then the day after, April the 21st, we have an availability for a worship leaders appreciation and training. Let me say it again. Worship leaders appreciation and training. We're so grateful for every single worship leader that we have. So we wanted to say thank you to you on that day. And those of you that are willing to join us are welcome to do so. For that day, please reach out to Caroline or I. Let us know whether or not you can be there. It will be right after worship on April the 21st. Worship leaders, appreciation, and training. All right, thank you so much.
Catherine, you might mention Maundy Thursday.
Yes, those are in our bulletin. This coming week, we have very special services, and we wanted to remind you to take a glance in your bulletin. We have a Maundy Thursday service with the Last Supper remembrance, and it's a light supper. So if you're a big eater, make sure you eat at home, because this is a light supper, like a symbolistic supper, remembering what the people of God went through in the Passover time. So it's like a remembrance at 6:30. Then Friday night, we love this. I love it because the lay speakers get a chance to be part of the action too. The lay speakers and I will be sharing the seven last words from the cross that Friday night with us. So we'd love to have you here to worship, hear the power of God's word in each of our lives, and enjoy a few hymns. And then Resurrection Sunday, it's on the 31st. And this year we wanted to do it, like I said earlier, super duper vibrant. We're gonna have a lot of hymns. We're gonna have a lot of worship together, and it's gonna be a very special day. So please don't miss it. Bring your family, bring your neighbors, bring your friends. We'd love to celebrate together, all right? So this is in the little tables next to the sound booths there, if you'd like the full version of the announcement for Holy Week, and it's also in your bulletin insert, okay? Thank you.
In our opening prayer is, Almighty
God, you sent your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross. Grant that we may share in his disobedience to your will. I think it's your obedience to his will, and in your glorious victory of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
find strength to face the day. And in your presence, all our fears are washed away.
We're doing this a little bit differently. I'm going to read the scripture. Please feel free to follow along, you know, silently to yourself. So this is from John chapter 12, verses 12 to 17. The next day, the large crowd that had come to the Passover festival heard that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. So they took branches of palm trees and went out to meet him, shouting, "Praise God! God bless him who comes in the name of the Lord. God bless the King of Israel." Jesus found a donkey and rode on it. And as the scripture says, "Do not be afraid, city of Zion. Here comes your king riding on a young donkey." His disciples did not understand this at the time, but when Jesus had been raised to glory, they remembered that the scriptures said this about him and that they had done this for him. The people who had been with Jesus when he called Lazarus out of the grave and raised him from death had reported what had happened. That was why the crowd met him, because they heard that he had performed this miracle. The Pharisees then said to one another, "You see, we are not succeeding at all. Look, the whole world is following him." These are the words of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
And if any of the young people would like to come forward.
You're going to need the microphone.
Good for you.
Hello, guys. You know, I don't know if it was just me, but I noticed the twins look like more grown up today. It's like they had a little growth spurt or something. Man, guys are growing up fast. Annabelle. So do you know why we make a big deal about the palms on Palm Sunday? Anybody? Let me read you another version of Jesus coming into Jerusalem. And listen for the part about the palms. As Jesus and his disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to Bethphage at the Mount of Olives. There Jesus sent two of his disciples on ahead with these instructions. Go to the village there ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied up with her colt. Untie them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything, tell him the master needs them, and then he will let them go at once. This happened in order to make come true what the prophet had said. Tell the city of Zion, look, your king is coming to you. He is humble and rides on a donkey, and on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did what Jesus had told them to do. They brought the donkey and the colt, threw their cloaks over them, and Jesus got on. A large crowd of people spread, here's it coming now, pay attention. A large crowd of people spread their cloaks on the road while others cut branches from the trees, the palm trees, and spread them on the road. The crowds walking in front of Jesus and those walking behind him began to shout, "Praise to David's son, God bless him who comes in the name of the Lord. Praise be to God." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was thrown into an uproar. "Who is he?" the people asked. "This is the prophet Jesus from Nazareth in Galilee," the crowds answered. So that's why we do it. It's remembrance.
Because it's like the branches that they put on the road.
Right. Yeah, so we're doing it in memory of what happened a little over 2,000 years ago. Right. And the people were a little confused, too, because a lot of them thought that Jesus was not going to come riding on a donkey, which is a rather small animal. They thought, I actually watched Gladiator, like Ruth was gone overnight for teaming, and I watched Gladiator for about the thousandth time. And Russell Crowe, the general, he rides on this gigantic war horse, you know, and he's got all his armor, and he's got a big sword and a dagger, and he looks really impressive. And they thought that's the way Jesus was going to look when he came into Jerusalem. So they were kind of taken aback by a guy just riding humbly on a donkey. And but Jesus didn't come to conquer the world with force. He came to conquer it with love. And sadly, a week later, a lot of these same people that were praising God were calling for his death. That's part of the tragedy of Holy Week. So anyway, that's why we use the palms, and you can make them into crosses too, and just like keep them in your bedroom for the coming year. So, Pastor, if you want to have a prayer.
Join hands, join palms, join something. Okay. What's her name? All right, let us pray. Holy God.
Holy God.
You're awesome.
You are awesome.
And we praise your name.
And we praise your name.
Thank you for Jesus.
Thank you for Jesus.
And for the sacrifice.
And for the sacrifice.
That he made.
That he made.
Taking our place.
Taking our place.
Help us.
Help us
to be grateful.
To be grateful.
By serving you.
By serving you.
And loving you.
And loving you.
With all our hearts.
With all our hearts.
Bless our homes.
Bless our homes.
Bless our hearts.
Bless our hearts.
And continue to guide us.
And continue to guide us.
As we grow.
As we grow.
To love you and serve you every day.
To love you and serve you every day.
Our parents are before you.
Our
siblings are before you.
Our siblings are before you.
Our friends are before you.
Our friends are before you.
Bless them.
Bless them.
And use us.
And use us.
To help them.
To help them.
Get to know you.
Get to know you.
This we pray in Jesus' name.
This we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Good job, Noah.
Do Good morning. Well, this morning, as cold as it was out there coming to church, my street was lined with robins.
Oh my goodness.
Praise the Lord. Spring is coming.
They have robins all year round at our house.
Any other God sightings? If not, let me do the offertory prayer. We thank you, Christ Jesus, for your steadfast faithfulness and your humble leadership in our world. Bless the gift we return to you now, that they may guide others to follow you and walk humbly in your ways. In your name, amen.
Amen.
And the offering hymn is Lamb of God. I think it'll be up on the screen, Dan. Yep, there it is.
Is to each of us, the sweet Lamb of God. Greetings in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. What a privilege it is to see all of you here together in the house of the Lord, either in person or online. Thank you so much for being with us. I'd like you to take a moment and greet the person in front of you, greet the person next to you or behind you. Let them know your name and that you're happy to see them here today. Yeah, behind you too. All right. So good to see the Wiles, the Nice, the Andrea and the Twins, everybody, the Casas, the Spears, the Greens, Judy's Army is getting there. Patrick and Linda, what a privilege to be in the house of the Lord together. I'd like to invite you to take a moment to pray with me, please. Precious Lamb of God, we are more than grateful and humbled by your love and your kindness to come and take our place at this cross and be the connection that we were in need of to be one with God. Lord Jesus, we take this moment to thank you and to praise you and to pray that you unplug our ears, unveil our eyes, and allow our hearts to be receptive to this word at this time, Lord God. be glorified and cleanse us that we may be more like you each day. Help us to love and forgive one another the same way that you love and forgive us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. And as I begin, I wanted to ask you, have you ever gone dart playing or axe throwing?
Sure.
How many of you have had that experience? I recently went axe throwing with the guys. Oh, my Lord, this was insane. Very interesting. And you know, when you throw a dart or when you throw an axe, there's that bullseye at the end of the line where you're throwing, right? And I want you to imagine, envision that bullseye right now. When we look at the bullseye, we notice that it has different rings. And it goes from small type ring to a bigger size, right? Now, when we consider the bullseye, I'd like you to be aware that as it gets closer to the center, when we think of a relationship going on, that small circle symbolizes a tight, close relationship. As the bullseye opens bigger, that means that it's like, well, somebody that you know, an acquaintance. When it gets bigger, it's just maybe somebody from your neighborhood or your community. As it gets much bigger, it might be somebody that you just don't know, a stranger. So as we consider playing darts or throwing axes, our desire is to do what? Hit the bullseyes, right? That's definitely the desire in doing axe throwing. That was not easy to do. But I want you to be aware that if we think about it honestly, building relationships is not always something easy to do either, right? And I am so, so grateful that our Lord Jesus Christ went the extra super duper, I don't know how many more miles for us, not one extra mile. He went all the many, many miles out of his great love for us. God sent his son to be that Lamb of God that we just sang about. And in order for us to be able to have that close relationship with our Lord and Savior, Christ took our place on the cross. And in the same as the bullseye, the relationship that we are provided openly because of that connection through Christ is to be in relationship with God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit in that center of the bullseye. And when we think about the lesson reading that we went through today from John chapter 12, I'd like us to consider that same picture and think of who could be in that inner circle with Christ. If we think about the story that we just read or the scripture reading that we just read, in the inner circle we found the disciples, right? We found Martha, Mary, Lazarus. And the beauty of it, that throughout the scripture we read that the children were also included as close relations with Christ. Now, in our narrative from our scripture, Martha and Mary and Lazarus had invited Christ to his house because they were so grateful. At the beginning of the chapter, we find that Lazarus had been resurrected, thank you, and that they were celebrating and honoring Christ. We talked about this a little bit last week. So this was an honoring Christ meal. And the inner circle people were there. And in the midst of all of that commotion, Christ's feet were washed or anointed with oil by Mary. And the time to celebrate drew closer and closer. In the midst of that anointing, there was an argument because there was a discussion of how this expensive perfume was being used. And we read about that in verses 2-7. And I thought that was quite interesting when considering that discussion because it brought me to think about motives. It brought me to think about intentions. It brought me to think about agendas. You know, in our daily walk, we make decisions. We plan the day. These are the to-do things in my list. And the same thing happens in the scripture here. We read that it says on verses 2-7. They prepared a dinner for him, Jesus, excuse me, which Martha helped serve. Lazarus was one of those who were sitting at the table with Jesus. Then Mary took a whole pint of a very expensive perfume made of pure nard, poured it on Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The sweet smell of the perfume filled the whole house. One of Jesus' disciples, Judas Iscariot, the one who was going to betray him, said, "Why wasn't this perfume sold for 300 silver coins and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, John wrote. A thief, and he carried the money bag and would help himself from it. But Jesus said, "Leave her alone. Let her keep what she has for the day of my burial. Whatever was left of that perfume, you will always have poor people with you, but you will not always have me." So in the midst of the celebration, there was kind of a small argument. And if we consider this argument, we can see, like I said, the motives were not really honest. This for Judas. On the other hand, Mary's motives were completely, wholeheartedly honest. She cared for her master, Jesus, so much. She was so fully grateful for the miracles that he had performed on her, who had been demon-possessed before and released from these possessions, and then her brother being resurrected from the dead. So she was just overjoyed anointing him. And then Judas Iscariot was like, "Wait a minute, that could have been 300 silver coins that we could have earned here." So the motives are really coming through in this scripture. In addition to that, we have Jesus is in a discussion about the Passover feast and in his way to Jerusalem to go celebrate. Now, I love how this scripture also tells us about the crowds that came out. They heard about Lazarus' resurrection, and they also heard about Jesus coming by. And the scripture tells us that the crowd gathered to welcome him with hopes of being delivered. And Dan was bringing to the kids a good point for us that I wanted to also continue to work on. The people of God in those days had the perception that Christ would come in this big horse with all this armor and that he would battle against the Romans and deliver them from the Roman Empire, deliver them from the Roman captivity and allow them to be free from the abuses of the policies, the polytheistic mentalities that they worship many gods, and all hoping that they would be conquerors next to Jesus Christ. That they would be free, that they would be delivered when Jesus came in victory as a big warrior. So that was their agenda. That was their plan. That was where their thoughts were. But as we know through this story, that is not actually what happened. In which of the categories are we is what I want to consider now. I'd like us to think about, am I thinking that Christ is a humble man who loved and obeyed his father? Am I thinking that Christ is a conqueror who is going to kick everybody out of the way for me and smash anybody that needs to be smashed for me? Am I in the mindset of I'm so grateful and forever humbled by his love, by his kindness, by his deliverance, by his freeing me, that I would give my everything to him? Am I in the mindset of not me, not now, I don't have time for you, Jesus? In which of these categories do you fit today? Is there space for Jesus in your agenda? John 12, verses 12 to 17, present a crowd of people that were tired, like I said, of these abuses, of these mentalities that were opposed to what they believed. So when Jesus came, they were hoping for that deliverer, for that conqueror, for that gladiator to come on their behalf, to take the throne from Caesar by force and to declare what they wanted to be the way to be declared. On the other hand, or opposite to their desires, Jesus' agenda was to follow the will of his Father. Jesus' agenda was always to do what the Father had sent him to do. In Luke chapter 22, verse 42, Jesus says those words in a very detailed way. So whatever, battery. All right, so when we think about that word, and I'm going to read it scripturally from you, word by word, it says, verse 42, Father, he asked, if you will take this cup of suffering away from me, not my will, however, but your will be done. So his mentality, his mindset, his agenda was constantly and completely to follow the will of his Father, to present his will submitted to the will of the Father. There's another scripture I'd like us to read. Can you please open your pew Bibles with me on Luke chapter 23? Matthew, Mark, Luke, the third book in the New Testament. Matthew, Mark, Luke. And we're going to go to verse 23. Matthew, Mark, Luke. Verse 23. When you have it, say amen. Luke chapter 23. And then we're going to find verse 34. Luke 23:34. This is a scripture that I'd like us to take with us as we prepare to enter into Holy Week. I think it's a crucial verse for us to inscribe in our hearts, in our minds, and take with us every day. Because every day we're confronted with situations that might aggravate us or people making mistakes that hurt us. But like Jesus said, I think it's important that we learn these words as well. Do you have it? Luke 23:34. What does it say? Ready, said, we read it in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Jesus said, forgive them, Father. They do not know what they are doing. What a lesson. What a model. And of course, that's not easy to do. But through Christ, we can do all things because he strengthens us. He guides us and he leads us in his righteousness. We can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And as I consider this word, forgive them, Father, they do not know what they are doing. Not only does that reflect on my imperfection, but also reminds me that all of us are just dust. We are nothing without Christ our Savior. And with Christ our Savior, even, we make mistakes. Sometimes we offend one another. Sometimes we hurt each other's feelings. So it's very important that these words always go with us. Forgive them, Father. And you tell yourself, forgive them, Ruth, for they do not know what they are doing. Now, we've been having the privilege to study a book called 24 Hours That Changed the World. Every Wednesday night we've been meeting. This Wednesday is our last gathering. And Pastor Adam Hamilton wrote this book, and it's been really interesting studying it through. Let me grab something.
Exercise.
So, Reverend Adam Hamilton has been really specific, pointing at certain things, and I wanted to share just a little glimpse of it with you, because it's juicy and excellent. My husband, Dan, has been doing a great job teaching us, and the bunch of people that have been coming have been excellent with their comments. We're learning a lot from one another. And I just wanted to share, again, a spot of it that really impacted me and has to do with what we're talking about today. Here, page 21. Says the following. The Passover is meant to be a festive and celebratory time, filled with joy as participants remember that those who were slaves were now set free, at last becoming one people, the people of God. Everyone was conscious of the heightened tension between Jesus and the religious leaders. They all wondered what was going to happen to Jesus, and then would there be repercussions for his actions in the temple? Might he finally proclaim himself as Messiah? The story of the betrayal winds its way through the rest of the Gospels accounts to the final 24 hours of Jesus' life. Before the night was through, Judas would betray Jesus, Peter would deny him, and the disciples would desert him, leaving Jesus utterly alone as he faced trials at the hands of his enemies. The echoes of Jesus' prediction and of the acts of betrayal by those closest to him are still discomforting. In our own age, when church leaders have abused children, embezzled funds, and more, we realize that such betrayals are commonplace. Jesus might well have said, all of you will betray me, including us. And with that realization, we must look finally at ourselves. When have you been a Judas? When have you been a Peter or the other disciples? When have you betrayed Jesus or denied or deserted him? The reality is that all of us will at some time betray him. Yes, even one of us. It is worth considering as we look at repentance and restoration that although Jesus knew Judas would betray him, Peter would deny him, and the others would desert him, he still washed their feet. Then shared the bread and wine with them, bread that represented his body and wine that represented his blood. Despite knowing what they would do, he said to them, I do not call you servants any longer, but I have called you friends. John chapter 15, verse 15. He did that for all of them, including Judas, the one that would betray him. Jesus looked past their betrayal, past their sins and their failures, and called them his friends. We should all take comfort in the knowledge that he will do that for us as well. And last but not least, he also made a devotional book that goes with this, and it's excellent. And I needed to just share this glimpse with you. It says, pursuing God's will is at times costly. Jesus said, if any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. Matthew 16:24. Are you willing, even grudgingly, to go where God calls and do what God asks, regardless of the cost. After arguing with the Lord, Moses relented and returned to Egypt, risking death to lead the Israelites to freedom. Jonah, in the darkness of the great fish's belly, finally said, "Okay, send me." And Jesus, despite praying for the cup to pass from him, accepted it when Judas handed it to him and drank from it, laying down his life for God's mission. Are we willing to keep our agendas aligned to God's agenda? I'll ask you again, is there time for Jesus in your agenda? Are your motives aligned with the will of God, the Father, for your life? Please pray with me. Precious Jesus, you know our hearts and our minds. Every thought that crosses through them is before you, O Lord. Have mercy upon us, O God. We have been Judas's, we have been Peter's, we have been these other disciples doubting, resenting, and not forgiving. Have mercy on us, O God. Cleanse us from within and allow us to align our agenda to your agenda, to align our motives to our motives. Cleanse us and give us an understanding heart, O God, that we may feel the way that you feel, that we may love the way that you love, that we may forgive wholeheartedly and forget the way that you forgive and forget. Be exalted in our lives, we pray, O God. Have your way in our households, Jesus. Have mercy on those that have not come to know you yet, O God, and help us to be a true testimony of your love and your kindness to them and all the people around us. These things we pray for the honor and glory of your name, Jesus. Amen and amen. And I wanted to make sure, if you have not had a chance to receive the Lord as your Savior, every time that I can, I will enforce that invitation. And I don't say enforce in a negative way. I'm telling myself to be bold and share that invitation with everybody. Some of you may have heard of Jesus, but you've never said, "Here I am, cleanse me from within. I'd like you to be my Savior." Or you did that and you have walked away from your love, that first love that you had for him. I'd like to invite you also to make a prayer with me. If you'd like to receive the Lord as your Savior, or if you'd like to refresh that first love, please repeat this prayer with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I ask for your forgiveness. I believe that you died for my sins and that you rose from the dead. I turn from my sins and ask you to come into my heart and life. I want to trust and follow you. I want to obey you as my Lord and Savior. Come into my heart, I pray, Jesus. In your name, amen. Glory to your name, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. If you have said that prayer and you meant it from the bottom of your heart, the Lord Jesus is there for you. He desires to be in relationship with you. And if you have just prayed that prayer for the first time, I'd love to speak to you after worship. I'd love to share some materials with you so that you may continue to nurture your relationship with the Lord. God bless you. Thank you for your boldness in saying that prayer with me. As we take a moment to turn towards concluding our time together, I'd like to invite you to please say a sang prayer with me or sing a sang prayer with me. The verse 3 of Spirit of the Living God, please. Holy presence, love divine.
Holy presence, love divine. Cast out my fear. Holy presence, love divine. Cast out our fears. Heal us, free us, lead us. Holy presence, love divine. Cast out our fears.
Glory to you, O God.
You know each of our hearts, each of our lives are before you. Our fears are left at the foot of the cross at this hour, God, because you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind, God. Remind us that every day. Be glorified in our lives and continue to mold us to be more like you, God. We present to you, Lord, all of the people that are in the St. Luke's Rehabilitation Center, including Molly Wheeler and Dan Goodness. We present to you all the people that are in the Morning Star out of Oswego, including Mabel Jagno. Lord, we pray for your blessings on the people in the Brookdale Senior Living at Liverpool, and we also lift up Eleanor Hoffman. Last but not least, Lord, we lift up the people at the Manor. All of the three floors are before you, Lord, including Lois Hyde and Louise Hyde and all of our friends there, God. Please bless them. Bless their caregivers and be exalted in their families' lives, oh God. You know that we also have ongoing prayers for Judy Beasley's recovery, for those who are suffering from the flu or COVID, for Amanda Lewis, for Baylor, for Emerson Tanner, for Norman Oil, for Nancy Stellingworth, for Noreen Butterfield, for Phyllis Nelson, Rosemary Collins, Miss Barbara Potter, Kane and Kristen Conger, for Debbie Bernard, the Diaz family, the Wiseman family, for Dylan Casa, for the Elsner family, for Sandy Palmer, and for the Women's Walk, Lord God. We lift them up and verbalize these names in one heart and one mind, Lord, so that you may be exalted, so that your hand may be at work even when we don't see it, Lord, that they may testify of your goodness and your power in their lives, Lord. I also include Sandy Faults in this prayer, God, that you may continue to work in her body and in her life, Lord. All of our first responders, drivers, and the people in that paper that's over there in the pulpit are before you, Lord. There's nothing impossible for you. I'll say it loud, Lord, there is nothing impossible for you. That's why we come before you at this hour, calling for you to be glorified, calling for your name to be exalted once again, oh God, that we may run to this altar and testify of the wonderful things that you have done. Thank you for the wonderful ways in the way that you have shown yourself in the body of Dylan Casa, Lord. Thank you for the great progress that she has been making, Lord. Continue to be glorified in this young lady's body, we pray, for the glory and honor of your name. Be exalted, O God. Amen and amen. Can you please stand with us as we get ready to sing our closing hymn, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. And like I said, this is the one where the choir is going to be doing some specific parts. So watch and be ready for the entries. Let me grab my paper.
find his music.
Now, I want to take advantage that we're here together today, again, to remind us that this week we have those special services and that we have fellowship today, right? No? I thought we saw, no? Okay. The 31st, I don't think there's fellowship either, but I do want you to know that next Sunday we're expecting everybody to come ready to worship, tune your vocal cords, and come ready to exalt the name of our Lord, because we're going to sing a lot of hymns next Sunday. So the benediction in this morning is from Mark chapter 11 and Philippians chapter 2, and it says, go into God's world, humble and kind.
We will be faithful, courageous, and true.
Go into God's world, gracious and loving.
We will bring Christ's peace to the world. For his glory.
Amen and amen. God bless you.
I don't know. I thought.
She probably should.
Lord.